Welcome, Nita. You are in San Jose?
Yeah, I'm in Mountain House, California.
Okay, welcome.
Thank you.
Welcome, Biji.
Jai Gurudev.
Jai Gurudev. I will start in 2 more minutes. You know, I said we'll start on time, but we have over 35 people have, you know, signed up for it. So.
Sure, no problem. I am waiting for a signal from my admin and then I will get started. Okay. Welcome. I have to. Okay, welcome to this session. And thank you all for your contributions, donations. These get channeled to COVID relief activities in India through OVBI, which is Overseas Volunteers for a Better India, and IAHV, which is International Association for Human Values. So it's a worthy donation that you have made. So quickly recapping for today. You know, what we are going to do is I have a few slides, so I'm just going to go through them. And in the first half of the session, I request you to, if you have questions, to put them in the chat window. And you know, like when I ask for it, somebody will read it out. So, and then I can answer. The main session should be done in about 45 to 50 minutes. And we have plenty of time for open discussions towards the end. Okay. So Today's topic is the Nadi system. There is a lot of mystery behind it. And so what I have been doing some research on is Agastya, who is a Siddha, his Nadi system. And before I close my talk, you know, I'll talk a little bit about the history of, you know, what documentation exists. Of course, we all know there is a lot of record for the Nadi predictions, but you know, I'll talk a little bit more about what documentation exists for how this Nadi system is supposed to work. Okay, so Agastya Nadi, it's a record of predictions made 2000 plus years ago. And these predictions are about people from who are living right now. I think some of you might have visited Nadi people and got some reading. So when we have a break, we can also have some of you share your experiences. And these records were preserved around a temple, Vaideshwaran temple in Tamil Nadu. And, you know, so there were families who preserved it, and there are families who know how to read it, because the script in which it's written is also very ancient. Everybody cannot read it. And the other thing is, in 1850, around that, when the British ruled India, there was a collection of Nadi records which are preserved in a library belonging to a king. And so they auctioned a bulk of those Nadis. I don't know about rest of why it was auctioned, but just an anecdote. So there were lots of records, lots and lots of records, and they are now scattered around. And also, I understand that, you know, people can read your Nadi on the internet too. Some of it has been digitized. So to understand the system itself, we need to understand three things. First thing is, like, you know, there is a lot of similarity between fractals and something called the Varga system. And I will talk a little bit, maybe 10 minutes, introduce it. The Varga system is important to understand, because without understanding it, the Nadi system becomes very difficult to understand, and you will understand in a bit why that is so. However, there is a major difference. The fractals are in the space domain, and the Vargas are in the time dimension. And I will introduce how these two relate quickly. You see this? You know, there are fractals in nature. I think all of us know there is a fractal design in everything in nature, including, you know, satellite images taken of coastlines, right? That's also a fractal. So Indian temples is like rich in fractals. You see the Gopuram style, North India, South India, you see that fractal recursion. Recursion is the term you want to remember. Fractal. Okay, so this thing you see on the left side is a carving in marble. It's from the Janakpur temple, Ranakpur temple. And actually, there is a fractal algorithm, you know, like, which will create exactly something very similar to it. So this is interesting. And the reason I put it up is I want you to observe that the recursions in this fractal, you know, you can obviously see there is plenty of recursions. If you notice a third degree of recursion, which is like a three sizes below the main fractal, which is in the main picture, you see that they are oriented. They are more or less the same size, but their orientation is different. Like, you know, some face up, some face, you know, to the right side, some face to the left side. So there is a directionality. And, you know, I am going to use this concept to introduce the vargas. So just hang on to this fact that in fractal, there is a, it's a geometrical structure, but, you know, as you recurse, there is directionality. Okay, second concept to understand is time markers in nature. Nature is filled with cues for life forms, right? So these are called zeitgebers. And so some of it is seasonal. We all know that certain flowers blossom only in certain seasons. There are also diurnal, like, you know, within the human body, you know, like we have hunger, sleep patterns is based on the daily routine, the daily motion of the sun. There are lunar seasons also. Many plants will flower close to the full moon kind of thing. And then there is an interesting 13-month cycle. This is a very recent study and research done by scientists, and this relates to coral reef. And they have found that the coral reef, you know, like there is a certain kind of coral reef which will only spawn in November, the full moon in November. And in some years, there is a 1 month delay. So it's almost as if these coral reefs are following the Hindu Panchan, where we have that Adhik Mas concept, right? So it's almost like they're following it. And remember, these coral reefs are primitive organisms which have been there for millions of years. Then there is a 12-year cycle. And, you know, many of you from South India, you know about this thing in the Nilgiri Mountains. There is a Kurunji plant which will flower only once in 12 years. And, you know, in 2018, this plant bloomed in 2018. So there is a 12-year cycle. So nature abounds in different kind of cues and different kind of rhythms. Within the human body, you know, this is a very famous or infamous discovery, I guess. It is called the cardiac coherence. How many of you know? You can put an emoji, cardiac coherence. It is nothing but the Nadi Shodhan technique. And to arrive at the cardiac coherence technique, they have been studying the active nostril. And they found that the nostril switch every 2.5 hours to 4 hours. So that's called the nasal cycle. And so that's a segue into biorhythms. There are many biorhythms, and this is one thing that, you know, scientists have recently acknowledged. And why am I talking about these different zeitgebers? You will understand in just a bit. Okay, so you know, the sun's movement around the earth, or what seems to be the sun moving around the earth, it's usually depicted as 12 different segments, right? 12 months, 12 segments. They're also called rashis, right? So, and then each rashi can be recursively subdivided. Each rashi can be recursively subdivided, and it's very similar to the fractal. So you can think of the subdivisions of rashi to be recursions in time. So in the system, it's common to have two divisions, 3, 4, 5, 7, 9, 10, 12, 16, 20, 27, 30, 40, 45, and 60. So this is called the Vargas. So there are 16 Vargas, and they are also called Lunar Kalas or Chandra Kalas. So there are 16 Vargas. And so you understand, just like in case of fractals, you know, we can go recursively down into it, and each of this subdivision is supposed to be a representation of some kind of a biorhythm. Okay, so now if it is like that, you know, if it's subdivisions or like recursions, we already know, and most of us know, that the Rashi chart looks something like that. The upper one is in the South India, and the lower one is in the North India. So there are 12 divisions, right? The top one goes clockwise, the bottom one goes counterclockwise. Other than that, they are exactly the same. Now, if I divide each of these segments into 9 subdivisions, based on, you know, like the fractal principle, they put these subdivisions back into these 12 squares also. And that is what is called the Varga. So now let's take the case of 9 subdivisions per Rashi or per segment. So the first subdivision will go there, second one to the Lagna here, third, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So, you know, you start with the top second from the left, and you move down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So that is where you stop the first 9 subdivisions of the first segment. The second segment subdivisions will start here. So it is the orientation. So like that, you know, you remap those subdivisions onto the same 12 division chart. And so this is just like the fractals having an orientation. Each of those subdivisions, you know, like in each segment, they all get mapped to into the same 12 boxes, yeah? And so this is what's called the Varga recursion. Just hang on to it. You may not fully understand at this point. So just remember, go back to the fractal, that, you know, recursions, you know, there is directionality. Just like that, in the Varga subdivisions, there is directionality. If you remember that, that's good enough. Okay, like every recursion in a fractal, like recursions are in a fractal, a subdivision has an orientation, which we just saw. And each subdivision is a window into a different facet for an individual into the future. So this is the theory. The division by two represents wealth, three siblings, four prosperity, seven children, nine spouse, 10 profession, 12 parents, 16 vehicles, 20 spiritual pursuits. And I am missing some more. So there are some more. Sun's movement in half a day and moon's movement in 50 minutes is needed for the 60th division to be calculated. So an astronomer needs to supply sun's position to half a day and moon's position to every 15 minutes to be able to calculate the most refined recursion in the Varga chart, which is the 60 divisions. And that's not a big deal. That is not a big problem. Even 1,000 years ago, 1,500 years ago, they were in a position to calculate, project the sun's movement to a half a day, mark moon's to 15 minutes. But ascertaining birth time is the bigger challenge for finer subdivisions. Unless you know the birth time, you cannot calculate the full chart. So what does it really mean? So we get to this breakpoint here. You know, in ancient times up to even 1800s, the clocks in India, whatever clocks, whatever form they had, they were 24 unit clocks. They were not 1 hour unit. And the measuring device was called a Ghatika. It's called a Ghatika. And then the Hindi name Ghadi is from that Ghatika. And in South, it becomes Nadi. So Nadi is 24 minute unit. So if you go back to the previous, you know, I told you about sun's position and moon's position. So moon's position needs to be predicted to two nadis, granularity of two nadis. Any questions in the chat so far? If you have questions till this point, what we discussed so far is that, you know, through fractals, we can understand the logic behind. We can understand the logic behind the Varga system. There is an idea of orientation in the Varga system. So the Varga charts are exactly like Rashi charts. They all have got 12 little boxes going around either clockwise or counterclockwise. And these 12 boxes represents 12 divisions in the sky. Each division is about 30 degrees. And whatever is happening within that 30 degrees is captured in one box, right? So if you are looking at a daily diurnal movement, then we are looking at, you know, like the eastern horizon shifting through the 12 boxes. And if you are looking at an annual picture summarized into these 12 boxes, then we are looking at the motion of the sun through the 12 months. Okay, so
there is one question someone has asked. Is this related to general Jyotisha?
Yes, these are all general Jyotish concepts here. I am just pulling pieces out from the general Jyotisha. So to set the platform for introducing the Agastya's nadi system. And you will see in, you know, 2-3 more slides how this Varga thing makes sense. Any other questions? Okay, just a few anecdotes. You know, in Tamil Nadu, there is this ancient literary work which is dated to maybe 3,000 years ago. And in it is a description of how the nadi parts are designed. So we know from that record that the nadi timekeeping was prevalent in about at least 3,000 years ago in South India. And recently in Dharwad, in Karnataka, they during an excavation, they found a school, just like, you know, you have Nalanda and Takshashila. And so, you know, somewhere in Karnataka, they found a school. School meaning like a university setup, about 1,500 scholars could live there. And the key, the center part of that thing was a Ghatika. Ghatika is a place where they would ring the bell every 24 minutes. So this idea, some of you will remember in schools in India, there is a bell, right? You know, there will be a person who will ring the bell after the end of each period. It was the same thing followed, like, you know, like this was during the time of Chalukyas, I guess. And so, you know, like they had the Ghatika building where somebody sat and notice passage of time every 24 minutes and they would ring the bell. So the point I am trying to make is, like, you know, the Ghatika thing has been there throughout India one way or the other. You know, scholars either in villages or in towns, you know, they knew how to measure time to 24 minute slots. And, you know, also 12 minutes is not a big stretch to keep time. But anything below that becomes questionable from, you know, my own analysis. Like if you get to the 60 subdivision charts, you know, it requires a lot more precision to notice somebody's birth time. So my own understanding is that, you know, these 60 division charts were available to super rich people where they could employ some, you know, like astronomer caliber people. Like, you know, of course, in palaces, they would have these kind of people, so they would do it. But I strongly doubt, you know, if they were able to do this in the villages. Yeah, so that is my take on it. Any other questions?
Yeah, there is one question for annual. Is it movement of sun or moon?
Annual, we saw two cases. One is the movement of sun is the most obvious. We are totally aware of, like, you know, the roses blossom in what, like, you know, late spring, camellias in late winter. So, you know, like all organisms are cued to the annual rhythms of the sun. Yeah. And psychologists also are making a study that certain times of the day there is more probability of depression. I don't know. People in United States might know. November is Movember because a lot more suicides happen among men in November. Some of you might know. It is related to some kind of a physiological rhythm. And these will take time for people to study. And of course, the annual lunar rhythm, I gave the example of the coral reef, which all of them, you know, it's a beautiful video. I'll try to show it towards the end. You know, it's a 2-minute video. It is an article in Nature magazine, I think last year or the year before, where every single coral goes into spawning, you know, simultaneously. And this has been happening for ages, millions and millions. So they get the cue from the moon. So moon is not just gravitationally impacting. That is what the Nature magazine article says. Moon is also has got a time signature within the autonomous system of living organisms. Any other question?
The question regarding annual for movement of sun, moon around the 12 houses.
What's the question?
This is what it says. The question regarding...
Okay, yeah. Yeah, okay, got it. Got it. Okay, so the 12 boxes are just a representation of movements. See, intellectually, time is linear. But our autonomous system, which is running on its own without our intellectual participation, it recognizes time as cyclical. This is true. Autonomous system, whether within the human body or anywhere else, any other life form, you know, it understands time to be cyclical. So time is cyclical and space is spherical, right? So you can take the 12 boxes to represent either a 12-month period, one solar year period, or you can also use the 12 boxes to capture one lunar cycle. You can also use the 12 boxes to represent a Jovian cycle, which is 12 years. Yeah, so that's the answer. Okay, so now we get into the next segment. So far, what I have discussed is non-controversial. Yeah, you can talk to leading edge scientists and they will talk about, you know, the cyclical nature of things in the subautonomous system in nature. You know, there is no contention about fractals in nature. There is no contention about time being cyclical. Now we get to this interesting topic of predictions. Predictions are based on two things. First one is planetary positions and the permutations among these positions. Planetary positions and permutations. And this is an intellectual exercise. You have a good astronomer, you know, who can take the position of the planets in the sky, map it into those 12 boxes. Then you get the chart. This is an intellectual exercise. the sharper the astronomer, the mathematician is, they are able to project into finer granularity, right? With telescopes, you get a lot more granularity than what, you know, if you go to the Jantar Mantar in New Delhi or Jaipur, you know, your granularity was something like 12 seconds. Beyond that, you cannot notice. But today, you got a lot more granularity. So this is an intellectual exercise. Next one is connection with the Varga Devatas. And we are going to spend more time on this. It's an intuitive gift. So any astrologer, you can check with any astrologer. They have these rules. And there are tons and tons of rules, right? Yeah, I mean, there are so many permutations, so many ways that the planets can move. Like, for example, you know, of late, a lot of astrologers are talking about Saturn in Capricorn and Jupiter in Pisces and how this is a very rare occurrence kind of thing. You know, those are all out of intellectual sharpness, no contention about it. But what does it really mean for Saturn to be in Capricorn and Jupiter in Pisces? That is summarized by a set of algorithms as dictated by some rishis somewhere. And the Varga system that I just described to you, it's all from the work of Parashara, Rishi Parashara, long time ago, several centuries ago. But drawing the conclusion from those permutations and those guidelines about, okay, this is what roughly it means, it's an intuitive gift. So here comes this interesting thing about Varga Devatas. Each of the Vargas, so what are the Vargas? You know, there are 12 boxes representing the cyclical time, 12 boxes. And each of those boxes can be split into subdivisions or recursions. So the D1 is the Rashi, which is the 12 boxes. D2 is called the Hora. And the Devatas for it are the, you know, the Pitrus and the Devas. You know, some of you know there are 6 months is for Devas, 6 months is for Pitru. The closer connection somebody has with those two, then they have a, you know, they have a say over the D2 chart. D3 chart is very interesting how they have created this. Is Narada, Agastya, and Durvasa. You know, towards the next break, we will discuss more anecdotal about this. The D10 chart is the Devatas of 10 directions. The 8 directions we know, like east, west, south, north, and then the northeast, northwest, there are 8 of them. Then there is also a down, and then there is an up. There are Devatas for each of them. So, astrologer who is in tune with these Devatas of the 10 direction, they are supposed to be the expert in reading the D10 Varga chart. Similarly, if you go to the D27, the astrologer needs to have a close connection with the Devatas of the 27 nakshatras. So on and so forth it goes for those. All those 16 Varga charts, the most refined being the 60 subdivisions, right? And interesting thing about these Varga Devatas, they are all Vedic deities, except the D20 Varga, it is assigned to Devis. Rest of it is all Devatas who are in the Vedic tradition. Varga Devatas. What are they supposed to reveal according to Parashara? They reveal a plethora of predictive secrets. So just reading the chart using, you know, a computer, if then else, you know, table index kind of thing, you will only get to a certain point. Using software, maybe you will only get to a certain point. But those who are connected with the Devata energies, and we will discuss a little bit about what does it mean being connected with the Devata energy by taking an example. Those people have access to a plethora of predictive secrets. And Agastya students, Nadi students, they trained in this, we will come to it. They also can suggest remedial secrets, which are very effective. Remedial secrets, you know, today you go to YouTube, you'll get tons of remedies, you know, for this, do that, do that. So those are all based on, you know, like heuristics, but in reality for a particular individual, Parashara says that, you know, unless somebody is connected with that devata of that varga, then the remedial secret is not known. Parashara established these guidelines about 2000 plus years ago. How do we know it? Because his work has been referred to by Varahamihira, a famous astronomer who lived 1500 years ago. And so he makes a reference to some other astronomer who lived after Parashara. So Parashara must have lived like, you know, at least 2000 years ago. Now, you know, just a question, a point to wonder on. If Parashara defined the 60 unit subdivision, does it mean that, you know, that 60 unit time requirement, like, you know, you need to know within one gati unit, that granularity, it must have been available. It must have been available based on the fact that, you know, Parashara created it and he is mentioning the 60 unit thing. And so now we get to the next topic. So we understood about the 16 Varga system, right? And how to map it into the 12 boxes, make it just like a fractal with orientation. So what did Agastya do? Agastya, we don't know if Parashara was before Agastya or Agastya was before, but there is something very common. If you take all the 16 Varga subdivisions, all the recursions together and overlap them, then you get Agastya's Nadi system. Subdivision. So Agastya's nadis has got 150 subdivision in the natal chart. So remember Varga, the 60 division Varga has got 60 divisions, but Agastya's has got 150 division. And also these divisions have got uneven gap between them. So they are not equal division gaps. And of course, there is a alternative to it where each division is, you know, like each division, there is an average gap and some people take that. Okay, so this is an interesting thing. How do we get 150? How do we get 150? So, you know, let's say, you know, you have a township with very few families in it, right? So, and there is a single school and a main road. And, you know, like the town people gathered together and they said, we need speed breakers now because there is more traffic. We need speed breakers and let's have two speed breakers from the school to the farthest point where students have to be collected. So it starts with two speed breakers. You know, a few years later, the city council changes and they said, you know, who came up with this two speed breakers? It's not enough. We need to have three speed breakers. So then the discussion goes, but what do we do with the existing ones, right? They want to have three. So they said, okay, let's leave it. Then what happens? You have five speed breakers. But, you know, you can see that the gap between the speed breakers is not the same. Okay, so let's say several years from now, you know, they say we need 12 speed breakers at equal distances. So at that point, you know, they will only need to create 7 more speed breakers. I don't have a visual chart, so you have to use your brain to imagine it. So it started with 2 equally distant speed breakers. Then somebody said, okay, let's, you know, add 3 without taking care of the evenness. Then some smart people came, they said 12, but we'll make it even. But then the existing 5 also got incorporated. So if you take all the divisions, you know, the recursions in the varga, 16 recursions, right? And then lay it into each of those square boxes, then you will actually have, you know, like 1,285. But then since, you know, like 135 of them are like, you know, overlapping, so, you know, you leave that out and you get 150. So this is the basis for the 150 nadi units. And it's also very nice to interesting to plot the distance or gap between these 150, what you call the nadis, you know. So that's a little chart and it's a very symmetrical. And there are like peaks and valleys and, you know, and then each of these 150 has got a Nadi Devata and they are all feminine devis. Any questions?
Is there a way to systematically study this?
I'll get to it in the last slide. Okay, so we'll move ahead. Nadi prediction. Okay, so if you just put your intellectual hat and think, okay, got this point, you know, there are 150, there are these recursions, these are fractals and orientation. Okay, I can buy into it, okay. So Nadi prediction, what does it take? It requires from an astronomer refined positions of planets, especially the sun and the moon. So you see the movement of any planet other than actually the moon doesn't matter so much when you get down to such refinement as 150 units, right? You get it? Yeah. So that is why the system is also called the Chandrakala Nadi. All that seems to matter is the movement of the moon. Not really. There are other planets are there too, but they are more or less static. So moon's movement is to be known within 1 Nadi. So, and birth time needs to be known to 48 seconds. birth time needs to be known to 48 seconds. See, even today, with, you know, like births taking place in hospitals, they make note of birth times, right? Do people note down the seconds? Birth records? Hardly, right? So, you know, it becomes like, it gets far-fetched that, you know, you can do a nadi prediction today to the extent that they were able to do at some point. And we will get to see that, you know, in two more slides. 48-second granularity. We need to know the birth time. And there are 150 devis. And you need to get the grace of these devis. Here, there is an interesting temple in Madhya Pradesh. It's called the Yogini Temple. Many of you might have heard about it in the context of the Indian Parliament building. The Indian Parliament building is structured. Architecture is based on the Yogini Temple somewhere in the heart of Madhya Pradesh. It's ignored place, but you know, it's very pretty place. There are 60 devis in the circumference and 4 sit in the center, very center of it. The 60 devis are there. Just like that in August year, you know, it becomes 150 devis. Okay, come to the second break. I told you we'll discuss about Narada, Agastya, and Dhruva. They are the key holders. They hold the key for the D3 chart, the third divisional chart. Yeah. So all of these are enlightened beings. All of these are enlightened beings, but they have different characteristics. Most of you have heard about Durvasa. He is famous for his anger, and you know, like from stories, he curses people. But did you also know, you know, he was also a boon giver. He would give lots and lots of boons. Any of you heard about the birth of the Pandavas? You know, they were born through the boon of Durvasa. So Durvasa was enlightened and he could grant boons. And Narada was very playful and he was known for his mischief. And in the stories it goes, you know, he was the first person. He was more or less the first one to be created by Brahma, right? And Brahma told him, no, you take care of creation, right? You know, you create more beings. And he was not interested. You know, he was so spiritually oriented, he said, no, you know, and then Brahma was annoyed. And he created 4 other beings, you know, there are 4 beings. And Narada, what he went and did? He went and told them, what are you doing? You know, like the real thing is to aspire for, like, you know, enlightenment, you know, drop doing all this. And so, you know, he spoiled them also, so to speak. Then Brahma created all the Prajapatis, and, you know, Narada went and tried to do the same thing there also, and he got cursed. Right? He got cursed. So it's just highlighting the fact that, you know, there are different different vibrations around them, different vibrations. Narada, playful. Durvasa, very compassionate but angry. And Agastya was very well known for his technical finesse. He was very, very, very intense in the way he documented stuff. Very scientific. And he was also enlightened. So you catch the spirit or the vibration of these three people, you imbibe it, then you are got the capacity to predict something more secret through the D3 chart. So the same thing extends to the nadi predictions. So this is more or less the final chart, and then we will open it. Nadi student, Agastya, had lots of nadi students who trained in how to connect with the energies of these different devatas. And Agastya's work was called the Chandrakala Nadi text. And looks like copies of this text were available around till 700 maybe years ago. So it means that it was possible for somebody to establish a school and train students and train them in the way of connecting to these devata energies. So one point that I missed making is that the Varga charts become more and more powerful as you get into more refined recursion. For example, in the first level chart, which is the Rashi chart, if something is seen and problematic, and you go to the 30th division, and something is more conducive, and if you can make a remedy for that, then you get over the issue in the first chart. So if you go like that, the 60th is the most powerful. And I want to mention something quickly about this 60th and it being powerful and how it connects to the power of the mind. The number of thoughts in the mind. We all have tons of thoughts floating around as I speak. There is a dialogue going on in your head. Yes, no, I agree with what he's saying. No, how can this be possible? Or something like, I saw this in the YouTube, but this is different from that. All these dialogues go on. If you go down to the refinement of a 60th unit, the number of thoughts, average number of thoughts in the head drop down to about 40. Based on what? Recently neurologists did a calculation. They found that men have 60,000 thoughts a day, women have 80,000 thoughts a day. So if I quickly do some math and take it down to the recursion, 60 recursion, the 60 unit, you are in a space of only 40 thoughts. And if you get down to the nadi 150, it drops down to a dozen thoughts. So have you wondered, in life, there are moments where you get a strong intention. you want, you make an intention to break out of a situation. You go through the same pattern over and over again, and you cannot stand it anymore. You get to a point and you say, I am not going to let this happen. So do you notice that intention, where it happens, is in that gap between the thoughts? So if you try to focus, so we also extend it the other way around. If you try to learn to focus, and if your first lesson is like you have to focus for 1 hour, is that easy? Or if somebody tells you just need to focus for 1 minute, which is easier, right? So focusing for a shorter duration is easier. The technique to predict is based on what can float up in the mind through intuition. Of course, you know, using the Varga chart, you can know, okay, you know, this person will have vehicles. You know, he'll be endowed with vehicles. But to know something more about that vehicle, you need to have something intuitive, something connected to that vehicle. And that intuitive thing comes as a lightning. And, you know, it's easier to catch if you train your mind to focus in smaller windows. And I believe this is what the students trained with in Agastya school, and also, you know, the heritage of Agastya. I'm sure, like, you know, I was just relating Agastya's work got, you know, like we know about it only because a person in Kerala, Achyut, you know, like, he created a work 700 some years ago. And in that, he has quoted several aphorisms or descriptions about this nadi system in that work. Okay, so that is how we know about Agastya's work and how this thing works. So going back, perhaps there were students 900,000 years ago who trained to, you know, develop intuition, and then they wrote down as their final exam. They wrote down, and the master gave them, okay, look at this particular chart, somebody who will come this time in 2021, you know, go look at it, see what you get. And they wrote down something that occurred to them. So if you see the Varga, you know, they could write about vehicles, money, siblings, parents, and children. So, and people who have gone, taken Nadi readings, they say, well, you know, I got this, and this is so accurate, right? So I believe that is what it's about. And it's not like, you know, predicting everything about everybody in 2021, but about certain people that the master of the institution assigned the students a particular task, and they put their intuition, gave their exam paper back, and then the master corrected it, and they are all collected as Nadi records. Meditation on Vasudha and 150 Devis is important. So for the Nadi students, they had to learn to connect with these Devis. And that is what has been captured in the documents about Agastya Nadi. Now we are at the end of it. any questions, you can type in the chat window.
Is this Achyuta Pisharoti, guru of Narayaniyam, author Narayana Bhattatri?
I don't know. I haven't done research enough. Maybe.
How can we get the readings online these days?
There are several websites, I understand, you know, like, and what they have done, somebody has done. Okay, so the way these Nadi records were gathered was in 1500s, King, Maratha King, who ruled from Tamil Nadu, he had a library called the Saraswati Mahal Library, some of you might know, and he tasked to go around. He was a great collector of manuscripts. And he went around and collected lots and lots of Agastya's works. And so the Nadi records were also collected and they were kept in the Saraswati Mahal Library. So these are the records that were not with individual families around the Vaidheshwaran temple in Tamil Nadu. So these are the records which got auctioned out in 1850 or something. And I suspect, you know, those have been around and they have been digitized. And there are people, you can Google Nadi reading online and, you know, I think, you know, there are a couple of websites you can find out and you can take reading. How authentic it is, we don't know. Any other question? Okay, so this is the formal end of my chat. So if you, so many of you contributed, donated for the funds for COVID relief activity through OVBI and IAHV. And I really want to thank you for the contributions. You can leave your comments about what you liked. You can reply back to the Eventbrite message that you received and it will come to me. And if you want to drop off now, it's fine. If you want to stay back and participate in open discussion, we will open the audio for everybody to participate.
There is one question.
Yes.
How did Sage Agastya know which individuals his students were to do Nadi predictions for in the first place? I had a Nadi prediction done over 20 years ago with stunning accuracy. It even predicted the date I would come to consult the Nadi prediction. No idea how it works.
Yeah, it is the 60th division. Actually, the 60th division can predict the timing of, you know, like when things happen, but it is the most difficult also to get accuracy in because, you know, if you just think about it, you need to know birth time to 48 seconds, right? And then for this is for the 60 division. 48 seconds. So when is the birth time? When is the birth time? Is it at the first breath? There is a lot of debate about what is the birth time, right? So, and there is an entire field in astrology. I'm not an expert in astrology at all. There is an entire field to correct the birth time. So there is a remedial thing where, you know, you can give certain events, you know, it happened like this, and then they can go and retro correct your birth time to great accuracy. These are like, you know, very well versed astrologers.
Krishna, can I share something?
Yeah, we'll open the bridge and I'm also going to go into gallery mode. All of you who would like to drop, it's okay to drop. If you want to stay back, you know, we'll have the discussions go on till 9 o'clock. So you can stay back and ask questions or listen in. Thank you all for coming, contributing for a great cause.
I was hoping before everybody drops off, I could share this.